In a huge observational study in reference to vitamin C intake and skeletal muscle mass, the researchers drew a very strong correlation between the two. Now, keep in mind, even though the research is geared towards those 50 or over, it could play a role all the way down the line, regardless of the years. And for example, you'll see in a second. But first, let us bring our attention to this particular chart. Now, keep in mind, we're looking at quintile. I know what's happening. You think quintile, if you're like me, the first thing you think is quartile, and you expect to see a box plot. All we're doing is looking at quintile vitamin C intake starting at 36 milligrams, I believe, going up to 170 milligrams in the fifth quintile, so it's broken into five groups, plus or minus 40. So we're looking at a vitamin C range from 36 milligrams up to maybe 210. Now, what I did is I put a line there to make it a little easier to understand. And what we're looking at right there is basically difference in fat-free mass as well as fat-free BMI. And you have the male and the females, both segregated into separate groups in reference to muscle mass distinction. Now, keep in mind, look at these numbers. We're talking between the lowest and the highest, 36 milligram intake to 210 milligram intake. And that is an incredibly significant difference. Let's go to the next one. Now we're going to look at plasma levels and micromoles. Now I think the cutoff here is 50. So we're looking at 50. Now look how dramatic that is. In reference to fat-free mass percentage as a proxy for skeletal muscle mass, and as opposed to having lower and higher levels above that 50 micromole level. And it doesn't take a lot. That's the most interesting part about this study. Even though it covered 10 European countries, over greater than 500,000 participants, so on and so forth, a lot of individuals, or a good portion of individuals, barely even get the recommended amount of vitamin C. But to proceed as follows. In order to get the level up, for every milligram of vitamin C intake, it represented what? About a 0.478 micromole per liter rise in vitamin C levels. So, to look at this chart as far as here, as far as this excerpt, it doesn't take a lot to get there. In fact, as we go through the study, you're going to find out how incredibly easy it is to move yourself from the bottom quintile, I want to say quartile, up to the top. Into the greatest amount of intake. It's just minor. But to proceed with the actual study itself, let me clear this one out. And it is, again, it's confounding, astounding, fascinating. But vitamin C, the correlation between intake and muscle mass, very, very strong. But to proceed. How vitamin C could help over 50s retain muscle mass, do not focus on that age number because it's going to play a role all the way across the board. New research shows that vitamin C could help over 50s retain muscle mass in later life. The study shows that older people who eat plenty of vitamin C, commonly found in citrus fruits, berries, and vegetables, have the best skeletal muscle mass. Quote, we know that vitamin C consumption is linked with skeletal muscle mass. It helps defend the cells and the tissues that make up the body from potentially harmful free radical substances. Unopposed, these free radicals can contribute to the destruction of muscle, thus speeding up age-related decline. So if you're 20, 30, 40, 50, or older, that is information to take to heart, but to proceed as follows. Now, this is actually kind of interesting. Individuals in quintile one, consuming a mean of 40 milligrams a day, we need to consume the equivalent, ready for this? Of just one citrus fruit, an orange, a glass of apple juice, and a vegetable accompanied with a meal, cabbage or broccoli, to achieve the same vitamin C intake as individuals in the top quintile. So, to basically equate to a difference of about 2 to 2.5 to 3% in muscle mass, at least in the study group we're looking at, literally doesn't require a lot of effort in reference to supplementation. It literally just basically requires a little bit of thought into a dietary intake and a few healthy fruits and vegetables, and you can move yourself. Look at all the time people spend training the gym just to gain a pound of muscle. You can move yourself from the bottom quintile to the top quintile just by an incredibly, incredibly simple yet gentle and eloquent dietary changes. But to proceed as follows, we're going to go right into the result because it kind of speaks, kind of says it all just by the charts that we looked at prior. Results. We're going to go to the full study, which is fully published DOI citation, and links will be there for you to follow as well. Positive trends are found across quintiles of dietary vitamin C and fat-free mass measures for both sexes, with interquintile differences in fat-free mass percentage and fat-free BMI of 1% to 2.3% for men and 1.9% and 2.9% for women, respectively. Similarly, fat-free mass percentage and fat-free BMI measures were higher in participants with sufficient than with insufficient plasma vitamin C by 1.6% and 2% in men and 3.4% and 3.9% in women, respectively. Remember, we're just talking this really, really narrow range between 36 milligrams and basically, you know, not even much as a children's chewable vitamin C and 200 milligrams. Associations were also evident in analysis stratified for those under 65 years of age and those 65 years of age or equivalent age groups. Conclusions. Our findings of positive associations of both dietary and circulating vitamin C with measures of skeletal mass in the middle and older age men and women suggest that dietary vitamin C intake may be useful for reducing age-related muscle loss. And here's a little, again, as you read through these studies, there's all these little tidbits of information which are just fascinating. And this one I like a lot, too. So here they are. They're looking at basically the 10 European countries, 446 million people, I think, in the EU. And this is how, and you basically almost have to avoid vitamin C in order to get levels this low. But here's an idea of how many people were actually deficient in vitamin C and how many people were actually suffering from disease-related deficiencies being critically low in vitamin C. What is it? 11.4 millimoles, something like that. 11.4 micromoles, sorry. Intakes of vitamin C range from 36.6 plus or minus 9.33 milligrams a day for men in a quintile one, which is the lowest, to 177 plus 44.8 milligrams a day in the highest quintile, which is 5. 38.9, 9.41 for women, 171, 43.4 a day in the quintile 5 for women. And mean interquintile differences were 133 and 132 milligrams a day. Respectively, in this study, 0.9%. Now, keep this in mind. Have this number sink in. And 0.2% of women, far less than the women, were classified as deficient according to plasma concentrations below 11.4 micromoles a day. So think of it this way. You have 446 million people in, let's say, your conglomerate, the European Union. If 1% of that number is that low, you're looking at close to 4,466,000, 460,000 plus or minus a little bit, of people so low in vitamin C, they may even have scurvy. That is a health crisis. And that's what I want to illuminate on. Of course, if we proceed forward, 34% for 34.7% of men and 16.8% of women, women obviously have a much better diet, were classified as insufficient due to plasma concentrations below 50 micromoles per liter of blood. So what I'm getting at is this. The vitamin C correlation in reference to muscle, strong, powerful, huge observational study, minor effort in basically to move a person from the lower quintile to the upper quintile. However, if individuals spent as much effort focusing on what they put into the mouth as opposed to what they put over their mouth, you know where I'm going. Wow. What a generational difference that would make, not just for today, but many, many decades down the road. We're putting something over your mouth. All right, whatever. Not going to argue against it. But however, what you put in your mouth has a far greater significance and a far longer lasting benefit to society as a whole. Again, Ralph Turciano signing off. Gratitude. Thank you. Once again, DUI citation and links will be there for you to follow. And as always, look forward to seeing you all the next 7 days And many of you already know we do our data analytics on Saturday. And the data analytics stuff is when I do bring things in reference to discoveries in reference to certain pandemic mitigation. So I don't want to date the video, so to say. All right, guys, girls, gals, other, thank you, gratitude. See you all next time. Bye.